Okay, so it's been a year since we've had the M1 chipset inside the likes of the 13-inch MacBook Pro, and we've also got the M1 Pro and the M1 Max in the likes of, say, the 14-inch and 16-inch MacBook Pro. However, for the next generation M2 chipset, how powerful is it going to be compared to the likes of, say, the M1 chipset inside like this 13-inch MacBook Pro? Well, today I want to discuss my thoughts with you around this. Hi, it's Matt here. So that's right, it's been a year since we had the M1 chipset in the likes of, say, the 13-inch MacBook Pro, the MacBook Air, the Mac Mini, and then earlier in 2021, we got the M1 chipset in the brand new 24-inch iMac and also the iPad Pro. Moving forwards into the later half of 2021, we got the M1 Pro and the M1 Max inside those brand new MacBook Pros. So looking forward to the next generation, the M2 chipset, a lot of you are wondering how powerful this chipset is going to be compared to the likes of, say, the M1 chipset. Well, today I want to discuss my thoughts around how powerful the M2 chipset is going to be compared to, say, the M1 chipset. Now, just quickly, I want to say a quick disclaimer. Everything that I'm going to discuss with you today are my own thoughts, and also it's been based on my own research. Now, I'm going to show you this research and how I've come to my conclusion and how powerful the M2 chipset's going to be, but it doesn't actually mean I'm going to be 100% right. But you're probably going to see from my research how I've got to basically how powerful I think the M2 chipset's going to be. And hopefully you'll either agree with me, but there's obviously going to be some of you who will disagree with me. So obviously put down in the comments below what you think of my research and basically if the M2 is going to be as powerful as you think I'm going to make it out to be. With that out of the way, let's talk about that M1 chipset that came out at the end of 2020 and basically why it's a good benchmark to start with to knowing what we're probably going to expect with the M2 chipset. Now the M1 chipset came with an 8-core CPU and it also came with either a 7-core or 8-core GPU. We've had the option to choose between 8GB and 16GB of RAM with this M1 chipset as well, but for that CPU we have 4 efficiency cores and we also have 4 performance cores, where with the likes of, say, the M1 Pro and the M1 Max, it's only 2 efficiency cores and it's actually 8 performance cores in that 10-core CPU setup. Now, I know there is an M1 Pro with that 8-core setup, with 6 performance cores and 2 efficiency cores, but today I'm not really going to talk much about the M1 Pro or the M1 Max compared to the M2. But if you do want to know how powerful the M1 Max and the M1 Pro is going to be compared to, say, the M2 Pro and the M2 Max, do write that down in the comments below, and maybe in the next week or two I'll make a video about that if you guys really enjoyed this video. Now, we've been told for the M2 chipset, in kind of leaks and rumours going around, that the actual core setup for the CPU is going to be very similar to what we have right now with the M1. So this again will be an 8-core setup, 4 efficiency cores, 4 performance cores. But we have been told that there is a possibility with the GPU that we'll get an option of either an 8-core or a 10-core GPU. And today I want to more focus on that 8-core GPU in that M2 chipset, because that to me is a fair comparison to what we have with the M1, because basically 8-core CPU, 8-core GPU, and then with the M2, 8-core CPU, 8-core GPU. So that's what I'm going to stick with. So you're probably wondering at this stage is how powerful is this M2 is going to be? Well, the best thing we can do to work out how powerful it's going to be compared to the M1 is look at Apple's other range of Apple Silicon chipsets that they make out there. And I'm talking specifically about the A range. So this is the range that you find the likes in iPhones, and also you find them in most of the iPads apart from the iPad Pros, and also you find them in the likes of, say, Apple TV, for example. Now with this A chip, I want to go all the way back to the A13 chipset. And the reason why I want to pick this chipset to begin with is because this is a chipset what was put inside the likes of the iPhone 11 and also, say, like in the iPad 9th generation we have now and the iPhone SE. Now this chipset is a big significant chipset because it was the last one to be made on a 7-nanometer die. Now, a lot of you are probably wondering, well, what's the 7-nanometer die got to do with anything? Well, it's to do with the actual transistor size, what is made to make the actual chipset. And basically, as technology goes on, we're trying to actually make the size of this die smaller and smaller. And by doing this, what we can actually do, we can get more performance and we can also get more efficiency out of a actual core of a CPU. So the reason why I mentioned the 7-nanometer chipset in the A13 is because of the A14 what came a year later that was made on a 5-nanometer die. And if you have a look at this chart right here, you can see on this Geekbench score that the single core score changes quite a bit between A13 to A14, and then it doesn't really change that much to A15. The main reason is the A15 is also made on a 5-nanometer die, just like the A14. You can see the massive change right here. So for example, there is a 21% increase on the single core score on Geekbench 5 between that A13 and A14 chipset. Well, it's absolutely massive. And the main part to do with this is because of that nanometer die sort of shrinking down. There is obviously some elements of Apple working with the CPU and actually making it a bit more beefier. And that's what we actually see between the A14 and the A15. If you can see here, you can see there is a 7% increase in speed with the CPU. And like I said, that's mainly due to Apple working on the A14 chipset, making it even better. And that's why we have that increase. This is the same again for the multi-core setup inside the A13, A14 and A15 chipsets. So for example, all three of these chipsets actually have a 6-core setup. So what they actually have is 4 efficiency cores and 2 performance cores inside them. And as you can see straight away, that there is a massive increase between A13 and A14 by 41% more power. And then with the A15, there's only a 5% increase in multi-core score. Now, one thing you may have noticed at the Apple event this year when Apple announced the brand new iPhone 13 range, normally in the past, they compare it to their last chipset that they made. But actually, if you notice, they were actually comparing it to the Android market right now, what was out there, because they actually knew that the A15 isn't that actually much faster than the A14. And to be honest, it wouldn't be very good to go to a presentation to say, yes, the new A15 chipset is 5% faster than the A14 that we got last year. So this is why they did this. But probably next year, if the A16 is on a 4-nanometer die and there's increases of, say again, about 30-40%, probably Apple will compare the A16 to the A15 chipset. So it's a very, very clever move that they're doing there. But enough of that, I'm rambling on. Let's continue on and have a look at the metal score now on Geekbench 5. So again, on this chart, you can see straight away there's a 26% increase of the A14 over the A13 with that 7-nanometer die. But then when you look at the A14 to the A15, then you can actually see the increase is only 16%, which isn't a lot. But a lot of you guys will probably know out there, the likes of say the iPhone 13 Pro and the iPhone 13 Pro Max actually has a 5-core GPU, and they've added that additional core in. And because of that, we actually get the increase of 66% over A14, not over the actual A15 with 4 cores, but actually over the last year chip. But you can see that's a massive increase just by adding in one more extra core. But I'm going to stick on the grounds of using that 4-core GPU, because at the end of the day, we had a 4-core GPU in the A14 and also inside the likes of the A13. So this makes this more a fair comparison. So if you haven't got it already, you can probably tell we normally get the most increase in performance in single core and multi-core when basically Apple changed their sort of die down to a smaller size. And like I said, with the M1 chipset and also with the A series chipset for next year in 2022, we've been advised that we're going to be getting a 4-nanometer or a 3-nanometer die. And with that change, we're going to probably be getting very similar results, probably to like what we've had between the likes of say the A13 to the A14. Now, it's more likely than not it's going to be a 4-nanometer die instead of a 3-nanometer die. And as you've seen in the A13 to the A14, that was a 2-nanometer decrease in size, where if I'm talking 5-nanometer to 4-nanometer, it's only one. So probably it's not going to be such a massive jump as what we have had with that sort of 2-nanometer sort of shrink down compared to the A13 to the A14. But there is definitely going to be a leap there. Plus also the fact that Apple also work with their chipset to push it as far as they can for their next sort of generation. So for the likes of the A16 and also the M2, we're going to see a big increase to the likes of what we had between the A14 to the A15. Now, just before I show you what I believe the M2 chipset is going to give us, I want to talk about today's giveaway. And that giveaway is for this. Right now on this channel, we're giving away a brand new iPhone 13 Pro Max in Sierra Blue, an 128GB model. And I'm going to be giving this away to one lucky subscriber when we get over 300,000 subscribers. And to be honest, we're not that far away. And all I want to know from you guys to enter into this international giveaway is basically put in the comments below what Apple gear you're planning to buy within the next year or so. Put it down in the comments below, and also at the same time as well, make sure you subscribe to this channel and hit that notification bell, because when we get over 300,000 subscribers, I'm going to be announcing who the winner is of this brand new iPhone 13 Pro Max, so you don't want to miss out on that. Now, just quickly, I say this quite a lot in my videos, I hate to say there's a lot of spammers out there and scammers who are using my picture, for example, and say you've won a prize or to WhatsApp them for a prize. These are all scams. They have nothing to do with me, so completely ignore them. Like I said, I'm going to be announcing who the winner is for this phone when we get over 300,000 subscribers. So if you get a message before then, it isn't me. Well, with that out of the way, let's talk about the M2 chipset and what performance it's going to give us over the M1. So with those benchmarks of the A13, 14 and 15, I've kind of calculated kind of the increase we're probably most likely going to expect on the M2 chipset. Now, I just want to remind you again, these are my own thoughts. And like I said, we won't know until Apple officially announce it. But basically, based on those results with the A chipset, you can probably see where I'm coming from. So first of all, let's look at single core performance. So with the M1 right now on Geekbench 5, we actually get a score of 1,745. But I believe we're going to get around about 2,000 on Geekbench 5 for the single core, what's absolutely phenomenal. And this will probably be around about a 15% increase. Now, if you remember back to my A slide that I showed you, the A13 to the A14, yes, it was about a 21% increase. But like I said, it's not a 2-nanometer drop in size. We're only dropping by 1-nanometer. So the increase is not going to be as big, in my opinion. So based on this, I believe we're probably going to get around about a 15% increase in single core if we had an 8-core CPU inside the M1 and the M2. So again, that's that 4 efficiency cores and also that 4 performance cores. And that multi-core setup is shown really well in this next slide here. As you can see, you've got the M1 with that 5-nanometer, and the multi-score at the moment is around 7,511. I believe that personally, like I said, based on that increase from the A13 to the A14, we'll probably actually get an increase of around about 29%, and probably the Geekbench score for the multi-core will probably be around 9,700 on this, what is absolutely phenomenal when you think about it. Now, the reason why I say this is absolutely phenomenal is if you have a look at this next slide, I've compared the M2 to the M1 Pro 8-core version. So this is the cheapest 14-inch MacBook Pro that you can buy right now, and this is the one that has the 8-core setup, so 2 efficiency cores and 6 performance cores. And as you can see from this chart right here, there isn't that much difference between them. There's only going to be a 2% increase in getting yourself that M1 Pro with that 8-core compared to the 8-core M2. And like I said, the main differences are that the M2 will have 4 efficiency cores, 4 performance cores, whereas the M1 Pro has a setup of 2 efficiency cores and 6 performance cores. So it's quite remarkable what technology can actually do with just shrinking down the die. So moving on to graphical power, and that's what I'm going to talk about next in the next slide, I just want to quickly say this. I'm going to compare the M1 8-core GPU to the likes of the M2 8-core GPU as well. There is a possibility, like I said, there's going to be a 10-core GPU, but I just want to compare it to what we're going to probably get with that 8-core. It keeps it fair for this comparison. And as you can see right here, there is a massive difference. There will be probably around about a 42% increase in that kind of graphical compute power compared to what we have right now with the M1. Was absolutely remarkable. And again, I've based this on the A chip series, so the A13 to the A14, when we shrunk down from 7 nanometers to 5 nanometers, but obviously I've subsidized a little bit because when you're going down by 1 nanometer, but you can see here that there is going to be a big increase in compute power, basing all my results on what Apple have done with the A series and when they've always shrunk down with their die size. Well, there we have it, folks. That is my results of what I believe the M2 chipset is going to be. And like I said before, I've said this twice already, this isn't official, but as you can see, basing it on the kind of A chip series, and if Apple do the same sort of thing with the M chip series, you can see how we've got to these scores, what I've just shown you right here. So it's pretty exciting. The thing what I find really, really exciting has got to be this slide again, where you can see that the M2 is almost as powerful as the likes of the M1 Pro with that 8-core setup. It's absolutely remarkable. Like I said, there is a difference of 4 efficiency cores, 4 performance cores in the M2, and obviously the M1 Pro has 2 efficiency cores and 6 performance cores, but it's really amazing how it shows it has caught up. But obviously, most likely the M1 Pro, even with the smaller 14-core GPU, will easily wipe the floor of the M2, even if that has that 8-core GPU setup, or even possibly that 10-core GPU setup if we actually get that in the M2. But anyway, guys, it's time to also wrap up this video. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below if you agree with this or not. I'd love to know your opinions. And also at the same time as well, if you haven't done so already, please do like this video. And also at the same time as well, if you want to hear the latest Apple news, reviews and comparisons, please make sure you subscribe to this channel and hit that notification bell. Until next time, guys, I will see you really soon. Bye bye.